Welcome to Nature Calls, conversations from the Hudson Valley. Our team's goal is to present science-based information about gardening and all things nature in New York's Hudson Valley. Hosts Jean and Tim, along with team members Teresa and Linda, are master gardener volunteers for New York's Columbia and Greene counties. So if you're interested in gardening or nature or nuggets of information about what's happening outside your door, settle in. Enjoy the conversation. Whatever the season, we have something to say.
Welcome to Nature Calls, conversations from the Hudson Valley. We're talking today to Professor Rebecca Pinder of Columbia-Greene Community College. Professor Pinder specializes in ecology, species diversity, invasive species, and ecosystem ecology. Oh, that's so cool. Welcome, Dr. Pinder.
Thank you for having me.
So, Dr. Pinder, you have provided advice to us master gardeners over the years about the invasive jumping worms, and I know we're going to touch on that a little bit today, but perhaps we could start at the beginning. Can you tell us a little bit about what your work has focused on in general? I assume it's soil and the creatures that live and interact there.
Yeah, I've always been interested in stuff that's crawling on the ground, and even as a kid, I spent a lot of time flipping logs and, you know, looking in puddles and ponds and lakes and things. And when I was at SUNY Cortland as an undergraduate, I really got interested in salamanders and salamander biology. And my professor there, Peter Ducey, he encouraged me to go to graduate school and convinced me to go to Cleveland, Ohio, where I went to work with Carl Anthony, another salamander person. I studied how human development impacted salamander health, particularly their parasite load. So I actually looked at how close they were to human development. They actually had higher parasite loads when they were closer to humans. But while I was there, I kept hearing about earthworms and how there were no native earthworms north of the glacial limit, and that they were really bad news for our soils. But meanwhile, I grew up handling earthworms, and I was finding them everywhere along the streams that I was working at. So most of my salamanders that I was studying were streamside salamanders. So after I graduated John Carroll, I ended up coming back to New York, and I went to University at Albany. And there I wanted to focus more on the salamanders, but kept getting sucked into this earthworm question. It was like a vortex that once you get sucked in, they don't let you out. But yeah, so I kept hearing about, you know, that they could be causing trouble in the forest for salamanders. And most of the studies were in upland habitats, mainly on redback salamanders. And so from there, I wondered, you know, well, what about the streamside salamanders? And I started looking around for sites that had earthworms, sites that didn't have earthworms. And what I found were stream sites were really great biodiversity hotspots for earthworms. And I also found several native earthworms. Yeah. And so previous to that, in New York State, there was just one little historical record of the species Eisenoides longbergi, and it was way out near Rochester, and it was near a truck stop, and so people thought it was kind of like an incidental or maybe an accidental record. And then the other species that we have around here is frequently found more in aquatic habitats. So that was kind of around, but there were actually papers written saying we're not looking in the water enough for these earthworms. And so I kind of got excited about that. And like I said, I got kind of sucked more into the earthworm world and really wanted to know how many we have here, who are they? And it turns out we have over 30 species of earthworm in New York State.
Native?
There's about five or so that are native. The rest are non-native. And so most of them are from Europe. Most of them, where they are more naturalized exotics than true invasives, but the European ones can become invasive. And then, of course, the jumping worms that are from Asia that are truly invasive species.
So even in our area, like in Columbia-Greene counties, there are native earthworms.
Correct. You found them? Wow. Yes, yes. And you really just have to know where to look. So they're not everywhere. Tim McKay out in Colgate, he and I authored a paper about Isonoides longbergi and how they really are in these crazy habitats that most other worms can't handle. So really low pH, lots of water. And so we don't know, is that just where their refuge is? Or is it that they couldn't compete with everybody else in the other habitats? Or do they just like that habitat in particular? So if you know where to go to find them, they're not too hard to find, but they're not super common. There's another one that is called bimastos. And that's one that for a long time I was looking for it, trying to see if it was here, because other people have found it out by Cortland and around there. And it turns out they like to live in the bark of rotting logs. And so if you're flipping a log and looking under it, you're not going to find them. But if you peel the bark away, sometimes you can find them. And so sure enough, when I realized where to look for them, they were here. So there's a lot of what really I like about soil ecology is it's crazy how much we don't know. We're walking all over the soil, but we have no idea what we're walking on.
And it sounds like the salamanders and the earthworms, both native and non-native, are really kind of linked to each other. So when you study one, you start getting sucked in, as you said, to the other.
Yeah, you really can't avoid looking at all the other species that are living there too, yeah.
And you're working on two projects right across the street at the Model Forest. One on salamanders that's just starting up, but also one on kind of leaf litter and what's in the leaf litter. Is that right?
Correct. Yeah.
Wow. That's amazing. And we didn't realize you're right across the street. We didn't bump into you and didn't hear about this yet, right?
Well, she's been coming here for 5 years and we didn't notice.
We're oblivious, obviously.
Yeah, we're easily distracted.
So we should first start with the leaf litter research that you're doing. Tell us a little bit about that and what you're trying to discover, especially in relation to kind of us as home gardeners and what kind of results you're thinking you might be finding.
Sure. So I got, like you said, you kind of get interested in all the other things going on, because part of the salamander earthworm connection is that the earthworms are eating leaf litter and the fungus and microbes living on the leaf litter. And that's also what most of the other prey that salamanders eat are eating. And so you have this really large organism that is faster at eating this finite resource. And so they often outcompete and strip down the resource faster than the littler guys can do. And it turns out through my research at UAlbany, earthworms are really not great prey for salamanders that live along the stream bank. So they are for things like the mole salamanders, the spotted salamanders, the marble salamanders. They're larger. They live in the dirt more. They can get to them. And most salamanders are opportunistic and they will fit whatever they can in their mouth. If it's moving, they can fit it in their mouth and they can eat it.
It has to be moving though, right?
Yeah. And then they'll eat it. And so I looked at what they were eating as part of that research, and it turns out they're really not eating earthworms at all. Very, very small number of salamanders had earthworms in their stomach contents. That's what I looked at. We could talk about that later.
Yeah. Right after lunch. Yeah.
They were also really small, like really, really young earthworms. There were no large earthworms. And so if you look at the size of most streamside salamanders and the size of most earthworms, they're almost the same size a lot of times. And so it's almost impossible for them to fit them in their mouth. And so I really started getting interested in, well, what does it mean for the other prey that's there? And, you know, part of the reason why I ended up at the Model Forest here was I was talking with Marilyn Wyman, and this was probably 6-7 years ago, and we were chatting about the deer exclosures. And there's a lot of interesting work that kind of links, you know, human disturbance, deer, and invasive plants, and earthworms are kind of all tied together. And so I wanted to know, where do the deer fit into this equation as well? And at the time when we were looking in the Model Forest, there really weren't many earthworms that we were looking for. And so I thought it might be a cool place to see it as a baseline. Mm-hmm. Also, I started teaching at Columbia-Greene at that time, and I wanted labs for our students. And so it was the perfect opportunity because we're only about 20 minutes away, and I really wanted my students to have real research experience, real lab. The labs that we did, I didn't want it to be just a cookie cutter lab that didn't mean anything. I wanted it to really be something that they could be proud of. And so we designed this project to look at if you are in the deer exclosure versus where the deer can get to, or even a place where we call it the brushy habitat, where they've harvested and they've left the debris, where are you going to find the most leaf litter invertebrates? Where's the diversity going to be the highest? And so every year in the spring since then, and I bring all the students out here and we sample the leaf litter, and then we bring it back to the lab and look at who's living in it.
In the three different environments you talked about.
Yes, yeah.
And what have you found so far?
So far, what's interesting is that brushy habitat not only has the most biomass in terms of the detrital food web, all the logs, the sticks, the leaves, but it has the highest number of invertebrates and the highest diversity. Hmm. So even better than just shutting the deer out, you know, leaving that brushy debris where deer don't really like walking through that anyway, but also leaving that biomass as a base of the food web is really important. The deer exclosure is kind of second, right close behind it, where it is, we do find a lot of diversity there. And then not surprisingly, where the deer have free access, it's much lower diversity, much lower biomass in terms of the leaves, and much lower leaf litter invertebrates too.
I love salamanders. I took my walk this morning, and there were about 300 of them out walking around with me, the little orange ones.
Awesome,
yeah. I was so excited. So now the invasive, we're going to call the worms invasives. What about invasive plants? How do they affect the leaf litter and the biodiversity?
So with invasive species, particularly plants, they generally take over an area and form more of a monoculture. Particularly garlic mustard is one that we have a lot in our woods. They are generally found in places that we have little leaf litter. They have a chemical, a plant chemical, that restricts the growth of other plants near them. So to be a true invasive species, you have to alter the ecosystem and cause ecosystem harm, cause economic harm, or harm to human health. And so really those plants are causing that ecosystem harm by changing the species composition, but also the soil chemistry gets changed as well.
Okay, so they're as bad as the deer stomping around.
Yeah, they're not great.
They're changing everything, chemically and all.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
it's kind of really interesting because it's almost like you don't really know what the cause. Say, for instance, you're not getting understory plants coming up or little saplings. Is it because of the garlic mustard? Is it because of the deer? Is it because you have less biodiversity? Or like, is it all of those things, right?
It potentially could be all of them. Yeah. With the particularly like maple saplings, the deer end up browsing them into more of a shrub than an actual tree, but they will eat them as they're coming up. But those are also going to have more trouble where there's invasive plants as well.
It's a jungle out there.
It is.
Okay, the other big jungle issue, climate change. Now, you've been doing this project for 5 years. Has that been long enough to determine any effect?
It's not, but I'm glad you asked that question because leaf litter is probably one of the things that people don't realize is so important to helping us combat climate change, especially in our area. Conserving that woody debris that falls on the forest floor, whether it's, you know, logs, sticks, leaves. The trees worked hard to pull that carbon out of the atmosphere and build it into a leaf. And so when it falls in the autumn, we want it to stay there a long time. And so one of the interesting things with the jumping worms, or even just any invasive earthworm, is they eat it so rapidly that we can't build up a bank of that. And a lot of people have looked at how salamanders fit into this equation. And because they're those generalist predators that really eat any group, with the exception of the earthworms, they can really drive down the numbers of a species that's getting out of control. So if you had one group of organisms that was getting too numerous, they end up eating them.
Right.
And so they actually promote biodiversity in the leaf litter, which ultimately slows down the decomposition. And really what we want to see is that slowing of that decomposition, because once it decomposes and the microbes eat it and respire, that carbon's going back up into the atmosphere. And so the more we can leave debris in the woods, the better. Recently, I was at a conference where someone was trying to rebrand leaf litter because they were saying, you know, it's litter, it's called debris,
detritus, all those bad words,
these terrible terms that they want it to be, you know, a resource. And they think of it as not trash, but, you know, treasure. But they were looking for terms that we could come up with. And no one really had any good
ideas. Always a marketing spin, right?
It is.
It seems to me, though, that for practical purposes, what you're saying, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, is that the gardeners should be certainly not raking up all their leaves and putting them in the bags and leaving them at the side of the road, right?
If they're going to compost, that's okay. But yeah, you should really try to leave your leaf litter as much as possible. And what's also in leaf litter is nitrogen, right? Mm-hmm. And as they decompose, they're leaching that nitrogen out. And so if you have a lawn or garden and you wanted to remove your leaves, I would suggest at least waiting till the end of spring. Mm-hmm. So any of that extra nitrogen can leach out. But then definitely compost it. Don't burn it and try to get rid of it quickly, because that's just sending all that carbon dioxide back up to the atmosphere.
But if I have a perennial garden and there's a bunch of leaves in it, you wouldn't really recommend getting rid of them at all, right?
You know, personally, in my own perennial garden, you know, I do touch up, you know, but I'm not as a tidy gardener as most people would probably be. But yeah, leaving that as a resource is important.
And I assume from what you're saying that you would leave, like if you have a woods and you have trees dying, that you'd leave the snags too.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. And so anytime you're harvesting lumber too, leaving that brushy debris, which a lot of people don't really like because it doesn't look as pretty, but it's really important to try to leave it to decompose as slowly as possible.
I just have a picture of Rebecca sitting out there in her perennial garden, going out to weed and ending up sitting there talking to all the little creatures under each leaf.
Well, there's lots of creatures.
Have you seen me garden?
In my mind.
Yeah. No, I do that too. I love looking at all the stuff I can find in my own garden, and I take pictures of all the, you know, centipedes, pill bugs, and
And I know we don't want to focus too much on the horrible jumping worms, but I assume that they are having a hugely negative impact on leaf litter and also the biodiversity, yes?
Yes, and many studies have shown that. And with our study at the model forest, we haven't seen them in our plots yet, but last summer I did find them with my river ecology class along the creek that runs through the model forest. And so I started looking around in other places, and they are in the model forest. Where they are, it looks like someone has raked up leaves in random spots, and the soil is very pelleted. When we have earthworms in our compost, in our garden, what they end up doing is taking our compacted soil and make it nice and fluffy, and their castings are really good for our plants we're growing. But out in the woods, they're taking this super fluffy resource that should be really spongy and able to absorb water and floods and lock up all our nutrients, and they just eat it quickly and then compact the soil.
Now, this is the European earthworms as well. It's not just the jumping worms, right? Because we talked to Professor
Gores
from Vermont, and we were really sad to find out that the other earthworms then, besides the jumping worms, are doing a number on the leaf duff in the forest as
Yeah, and it really depends on where you are and how numerous the earthworms are. So if you went to anywhere in Greene County right now, you could go to spots where we have nice thick leaf litter and just a few worms, or places where we're loaded with both European and invasive jumping worms. And so it really does depend. But yeah, the European ones, when they're numerous, can do the same thing. They're just not as quick about it, and they're not as fast to invade. So that they're eating the leaf litter a little bit more slowly than the jumping worms, and then invading a little bit more slowly as well.
Okay, let's go back to the good guys and talk about some salamander
stuff.
You are more interested in the salamanders that are aquatic or are in the stream side, because the ones I see are my little friends, the orange ones, and the black ones with the spots, and then there's another one.
Yeah,
what are they?
Yellow-spotted salamanders.
Yellow-spotted, okay. And then there's one that looks like kind of a snake only with feet, and it's got like a triangular head or diamond shape maybe.
Snake would
maybe it's another. Maybe it's another.
It's like some mutant on Gene's property.
It might be. It's a mutant that lives at my house.
What color is it?
It's like brownish, tannish.
Maybe a redback?
Maybe it's a baby and it hasn't got all its color or something.
Yeah, maybe.
I don't know.
Well, they can have the redback salamanders can be, you know, the classic with the really brick red stripe on the back, all the way to tan. Some of them are all red. Some of them are all black.
Oh, so there's more to find.
There's more different color, all these different colors that are there, yeah.
Okay, now I heard a rumor, and I don't quite understand it, but that you're laying tiles in the forest to do with salamanders. What's that?
Yes, I am laying tiles, flooring tiles out in the forest.
Oh, flooring tiles?
Literally flooring tiles.
Like they're 12 by 12. Okay.
No, I bought them new.
Oh, okay. New ones. Okay.
They are, yeah, we bought them from Lowe's.
Okay.
They were the cheapest artificial cover object we could get.
I think that's what's in my kitchen, too, the cheapest artificial
Yeah.
But it turns out that flooring tiles make great cover objects to study salamanders. And so an artificial cover object is any kind of object you would put in the woods hoping that a salamander would hide under it. And so a lot of people use flooring tiles. Some people who have bigger budgets use really nice hardwood planks. I have a small budget, so I went with the flooring tiles. But what they kind of mimic is our sedimentary rocks. So they're clay, and they actually make great places for the salamanders to hide. And so I am laying flooring tiles out in Model Forest. And I am putting them with the CFI plots and the continuous forest inventory plots.
Which is that?
Those are the plots that are set across the entire model forest in a grid. And so they're all evenly spaced. It's as if someone looked at a map and put dots on it in a grid pattern.
Okay.
And so it's a very systematic way. If you're sampling out and doing field work, you really want to try to be systematic about it so they don't have bias when
and they're different environments.
Yeah. Okay. So you get a wide variety. And so they've been doing that for years. And again, this was another opportunity that I seized on.
Well, model forest, right?
It's a model forest. Go. They know all of the trees that are in these plots. They've been watching how they grow and what's affecting different practices of management. How does that affect their growth? And so I thought, why not add another layer of information? How does that management affect our salamanders?
Wow.
And are our salamanders going up in number? Are they declining? Do we have a lot of diversity? To my knowledge, there was one other study done in the model forest to survey for the salamander species, and it's quite rich in diversity over there. They've got quite a good population of multiple different species.
Some good news.
Yeah,
we
good
need
community
good
there. Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know. This may be a question that's specific to me, of course, which I always like to ask those questions, but hopefully it's in general too. So I had spotted salamanders in, I have a little pond next to the woods, and I am not seeing them anymore. And I also have Asian jumping worms in the last few years. And I know you can't just make that jump of logic, but I assume that if you start seeing fewer different types of species of salamanders, which I had a number in my pond, then that's not a good thing, right?
Right. And in general, like you say, you can't blame the worms necessarily, but in general, amphibians are declining worldwide and for various reasons. A lot of it's human destruction of their habitat or even just making smaller and smaller patches for them to live on in their habitat. But a lot of people worry about there's a fungus that does take out a lot of amphibians. People have documented that worldwide there's an amphibian decline, and we don't have a lot of great information as to what's happening in New York State. And so, again, you know, the model forest has this great setup. And so what I want to see is if we start monitoring now, will we detect a change, whether positive, negative, whatever it may be? And then having that data of management practices, we can then start formulating hypotheses that we can then test to see, is one type of management practice harming or helping them? Or with our invasive plant species, is what effect does that have? And like I said, now having the jumping worms over in the model forest, hopefully we can determine what effect they have, if any, on them.
And in the meantime, since we hear all this bad news and we're all gardeners, and I assume most of the people listening are gardeners, is there anything that you could suggest that we do, or any tips or anything to try to conserve the biodiversity that we have? I will add new soil, sometimes better soil if my soil's depleted. Should we add mulch? Should we, you know, and what is there anything like that that we can do that would help?
In terms of adding mulch, especially with the jumping worms, you do have to be careful because their cocoons are really hardy. So the worms themselves are not super hardy. Even I've collected some with students, and then by the time we get back to the lab, they're very sad looking. But their cocoons are super hardy, and they can overwinter. They can overwinter multiple years. So they almost build up like a seed bank until the conditions are right. And so you do have to be careful with adding any kind of soil product to your garden, because they could be hiding in there without sifting through, right, you know, all the soil. Because you can sift them out if you know what you're looking for. You can find them, but that's probably not practical for the average gardener.
No. But I mean, if you already have them and your soil is in poor shape, I mean, would you bring in some topsoil, or is that still not something? I'm trying to think of something that we could do that make us feel better. About all these things happening.
Well, I think if you already have them, you're not doing any harm by adding. You're helping your garden by adding extra soil. Mm-hmm. So it's not going to be worse.
Right. I'm just thinking about when my overwintering perennials, if you think, oh, they're not going to do well because the soil is so pelletized, as you said, maybe just adding some, that's one of the things I've tried to do. And
in terms of mulch, I would say things like straw, mm-hmm. you know, more natural mm-hmm. Options than the bark chips that a lot of people
buy. It would break down and it wouldn't necessarily have any kind of cocoons in it or anything like that.
You said early on that human influence increased the number of parasites with the salamanders. In the Siusla forest across the street, are you seeing less, or like on the areas that are closer to, say, the highway and where people are you seeing a difference?
In salamander numbers?
In the salamander. Well, not in the number per se, but in the number of parasites and difficulties and responses to environment.
Well, with these guys, I haven't looked at their parasite load. And we're just starting out, so I don't really know what even our baseline is for them yet. But hopefully as we move forward, we can at least find who do we have and how many are there. One thing I am really interested in is the age structure of the population, meaning is it all adults or do we have a good number of young salamanders? What a lot of people don't realize is salamanders live a long time.
How long?
Like 7 to 10 years, wow. Some Ooh. Even more. Some of those mole salamanders, like the spotted salamanders, people have kept them in captivity for 20 years. They're really long-lived animals, and they don't mature very quickly. So you may have a lag time between when you have an issue and when you really start to see the population drop. And so when you look at age structure, you can really see, do we have young salamanders that are going to grow up and reproduce, or are we just left with adults that in a very short time our population is going to crash? Mm. So that's something I'm hoping to find out, but I don't know right now.
So it could actually be predictive of what's going to happen in terms of their populations in the future.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, that's a great tool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's awesome.
So we often ask this question. I always say when I do presentations that gardeners really can make a difference. How many things can you say that about? Can you tell us what you think are the most important things in terms of home gardeners and encouraging biodiversity? What would you say to people out there who are looking for some hope?
I think feeling like you can do something is very important. And it always starts with yourself, right? And knowing what's in your backyard. I highly encourage everyone just look around and see what species you have. once you start really looking, especially if you have kids, and showing them what's under logs and showing them what's in your own backyard, you'd be amazed at, even in an urban setting, the amount of biodiversity you have. And I think paying attention to what's happening locally and being mindful of that biodiversity is really important.
Would you encourage people to use iNaturalist or field guides?
Yes, I absolutely encourage people to use those. And I use Seek. It's very helpful. You just hold it in front of your organism. It takes a picture. And in my experience, it's fairly accurate.
So you talked about understanding what's on your property and what's there. I know there's iNaturalist, there's Seek, there's all of these different field guides. What about citizen science projects?
I'm so glad you asked. With the flooring tiles that we're setting out, it's part of a community outreach program that we have just launched this spring. We just had our first citizen science program where we invited families, kids of all ages came out and looked for salamanders. And so it's a great way to get involved. We talked about how to identify them. And then we did some real science where the participants were actually coming out and counting the salamanders that were under the tile. So we're hoping to have another event in the fall and make it a regular thing where you can come out and count salamanders with us.
That's so cool.
It was a really fun time.
Yeah. Gina and I will be there.
Awesome. Also, I was just thinking about pesticides. We were talking about humans dominating the landscape, and we can easily avoid using pesticides in our own home and encouraging our neighbors to do that too. And it not only helps the natural biodiversity in your own yard, it helps the pollinators that are flying through, it's helping our birds. So I think that is something you can do too, but just paying attention to what's around you and what's in your own backyard.
That sounds like a great idea,
yeah.
Start in our own backyard. And thank you for a peek into what's going on in the forests and the wilderness and along the stream beds. That was very interesting. Thank
you. And the floor tiles.
And the floor tiles, especially the floor tiles. Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
That concludes another episode of Nature Calls, Conversations from the Hudson Valley. We would like to thank Sandra Linnell and Devin Connolly from Cornell Cooperative Extension of Columbia and Greene Counties for production support. And a special thank you to our listeners for joining us on this episode of Nature Calls, Conversations from the Hudson Valley. You can find links to any of the topics mentioned in this episode at our website at ccecolumbiagreene.org. Comments and suggestions for future topics may be directed to us at columbiagreenemgb@cornell.edu or on the CCE Master Gardener Volunteers of Columbia and Greene Counties Facebook page. For more information about Cornell Cooperative Extension of Columbia and Greene Counties, visit our website at ccecolumbiagreene.org or visit us in Hudson or in Acre. Cornell Cooperative Extension provides equal programming and employment opportunities.